So maybe if we can begin. So in the last lecture, we derived the Lenz equation, the basic Lenz equation that we use to model any given mass distribution. And we also briefly talked about the time delay surface and what role it plays. So in this talk, in this lecture, I'll go into a bit more detail about the time delay surface and the nature of the images. So first, based on Ajith's request, I will go through the derivation of the time delay, because it's a very fundamental quantity. So like yesterday, so we have a source on the source plane. You have the lens plane where there is a potential, and then there's an observer. And you want to compute the time delay. So without loss of generality, let's put the source at the origin here. So I should remind you that so the physical coordinates on the source plane were labeled with capital Y, and angular coordinates were S, right? And similarly here. And in the first tutorial, you would also have derived the relation between DL, DS, and the commonly used distances in the FRW metric. So I'll just write them down here. So it's in general easier to do the calculations if you use the FRW metric, or where you scale out the expansion of the universe. So the line element, which is the scale factor, it's the function of time. So this x is not the same as this x, sorry. But so this chi is known as the conformal time. So given in terms of the Hubble rate, and the x, so these are the co-moving coordinates. So if you sit at a constant x, you are partaking in the Hubble expansion, right? And the angular diameter distances are defined as which I'll call chi L, for brevity. Yes. So let's first ask, what is the job? So as I mentioned yesterday, the total time delay for a ray, we can measure it relative to the fiducial ray, which would have gone on straight if there were no matter there. So the total time delay is the sum of a geometric component, which is just the fact that you're going up and coming back. And the second part is the Shapiro delay, which arises because of the potential here. So let's first write down the geometric component. So we want C delta tau of the geometric. So a note is that the tau is always measured on the world line of the observer, who is at redshift zero. So, but for the if the observer is sitting at, is partaking in the Hubble expansion, he's sitting at constant co-moving coordinate, then at zero redshift, chi is his proper time. So if we just compute the change in chi between this ray and this ray, that is directly the difference in proper time as seen by the observer. So, and in this metric, everything is just follows Pythagorean law, so it's very easy. So first the first part will be, so this displacement here, so in angular units it was what we called y minus x, right? So this is the change in the position of the source as seen by, because of the lens. So this is where it's hitting the lens plane. And in physical units, this is y minus x. So in co-moving units, this is phi minus x times chi L. Right, so this is chi L. This is chi LS. And this sum of both of these is called chi S. It's the whole thing. Plus the second ray. And minus the direct one. So if we assume that the deflection is small, so the chi ls plus chi l, and Taylor expand these square roots, the chi ls and chi l cancels this, and you have, everything else is proportional to this square of this quantity. So let me pull that out. So the first term gives you, the second term gives you chi l. And now if we use this identity, so this is, so then this simplifies to chi S, chi M, or chi LS. And now if I use these identities, so this is the geometric delay, and then we have the Shapiro delay, which is, so for to calculate the Shapiro delay, let's enter into the rest frame of the lens. So in this frame, the metric, so keep the constant or signature constant. So here t is the proper time. So the, so this is the line element. So, and the light ray propagates along a null path. So this is zero. So and if we adopt the assumption that we have been doing so far, that phi is small, it's Newtonian, right? So this is the, so this is what we'll call the, so the Shapiro part is this thing, right? So let's calculate, let's split this into two components. One is, so if I'm sitting here, right, ray is coming here, getting deflected and going here. So let's split it into the incoming part and the outgoing part. So So I'll take away the constant part. Right? So the DL is the affine parameter along this ray. So if I substitute phi so let's call this the impact parameter B. So the first thing to note is that as written down, this integral doesn't converge, but we don't care because there'll be some regulation at large distances. All we really care is how this varies with B. So let's now it's a delta because I've integrated over this. So it's going to start there. So here I'm assuming that there's a point mass and I'm going to build from that. And this thing is 1 over B. So we get that this is B. So we see that it goes logarithmically with the impact parameter. So plus some constant term which we don't care about. So and the outgoing ray will also give you the same answer with some possibly different constant, but again, so the total okay, so now let's go from the point mass to a continuous mass distribution. So this is what we did yesterday. We will replace the mass with some surface mass density sigma. So let's write that. So this is an integral over the lens plane. So this is physical units. So let's get back to the angular units so that and yesterday we defined the dimensionless surface mass density kappa, which was sigma the critical dense surface mass density, which we had derived. Right. So let's write this in terms of the dimensionless kappa. So you get one factor of this. And this quantity is what we had called the deflection potential yesterday. So we get that this is but this was measured at in the frame of this lens, and we were interested in what's the change that the observer sees. So this will redshift. So that will give you a factor of 1 plus z. So if I just add it and get the total C delta tau as seen by the observer. Okay, so this is some dimensionful thing, and this thing is, has dimensions of the square of the angle. So this is called the Fermat potential. And as you can see, if you take the gradient of this quantity with respect to x, you will get the lens equation back, as we should. So let's, to get a feel for what is the typical scale involved. So as I mentioned, this is angle squared, right? So the typical angular scale involved in strong lensing is the Einstein scale. So we can guess that typically this will be of the order of the Einstein radius square. So we see that these factors cancel out. So the typical C So essentially, for order of magnitude level estimates, the typical time delay you see is of the order of the Schwarzschild, the crossing time of the Schwarzschild radius of the lens. Okay, wherever the lens might be. So for just to get some idea of the typical scales, for if the lens is a solar mass star, so you know that the Schwarzschild radius of the sun is 3 kilometers. So that means that the typical time delay, if you have a point mass lens, which is one solar mass, is going to be of the order of 10 microseconds. And instead of the sun, if you have a galaxy, so you have Milky Way sized galaxy, this quantity will be around 10 to the 7-ish seconds, I guess, yes, roughly. And since we are neglecting some order of magnitude, some order unity factors, it will be typically this. So a year, it's 3 times 10 to the 7 seconds. So this means for a galaxy lens, the typical time delay will be of the order of months to a year, just to have an idea of what would be the scales. Yes, around a year. Okay. So far, so good. So from the beginning of these lectures, we have been working in the geometrical picture where we are only working with rays. And it will help us a little bit. It will give us a different perspective if we look at what's happening to the wave. So I'll just briefly describe that. you had the source and you had a lens here. You have an observer. So the source is emitting. So we derived the rays as the integral curves of the derivative of the phase. So back from the first lecture. Right. So if we take all the rays that emanate from the source and look at surfaces of constant V, so these are what you would call wave fronts. So initially they are spherical, so they go out. And then they start to see the lens. And then you have a Shapiro delay because of the lens. So they start to develop. A kink. And then if the lens is strong enough or the impact, if the lens is strong enough, you're going to have the wavefront self-intersects. You get so if you take the contours of the region where it has self-intersected, so these are what you would call the caustics of the future light cone of this event in JR, right? So these will turn out to correspond to our lensing caustics and critical curves that I mentioned. Right? And so if you look, so you can think of the caustics as forming some sort of cone-shaped surface. And if you as an observer, so let's imagine a hypothetical observer and let's move them in, you know, at this redshift around. So if the observer is outside this cone of the caustics, essentially they are going to see just one image because the wavefront is going to hit them only once. And the wavefront has been slightly bent, so there is some deflection, right? And then when the observer enters the caustics, so say there is some, so let's take the observer here. You will see that the wavefront, it hits them multiple times. So these are what we have been calling multiple images of the same source, right? So the time delay between the images corresponds to the time between successive crossings of the wavefront at the location of the observer. And you can also see that the normal to the wavefront is different on different branches. So that means the observer sees the images as coming from different locations on the sky. So all the aspects that we have been talking about, they are there even in wave optics, right? And you can also see this illustrates that, so as you move here, once you enter the region where there are these caustics, the image that is distant was not affected. Still, that branch of the wavefront is going to cross you. But new images have been created here. And if you are on the caustic cone, then the two new images, they are coincident in location. So this is what I was saying yesterday, that when you move and hit the caustics, two new images are born or die. So that is corresponding to this wavefront here. I mean, this does not give us any more insight in calculation than this picture, but it just helps you understand what's going on. So now, in the rest of the lecture, I'll derive some properties of the multiple images. And also, I'll look in a bit more detail at what's happening near the caustics. Because and show some general properties of the lens equation there. So if you recall yesterday, we classified the images according to whether they were at a minimum of the time delay surface, a saddle point, or a maximum. So we call images as images of type 1. So they were classified based on the Jacobian of the lens equation. So again, I'll write it down. So it should. So the Jacobian. This was a 2x2 matrix. This was a symmetric matrix that described the distortion of infinitesimal displacements on the source and image planes. So the images of type 1 at their location, the Jacobian matrix has positive determinant, so which was related to the inverse of the magnification. So or again for And not only that, but both the eigenvalues of this matrix were positive. So we wrote this matrix in terms of the convergence and shear. So this was 1 minus. Where gamma 1 and gamma 2 were the two components of the shear. And in yesterday's exercise, you would have derived how they transformed under a change of coordinates. And kappa is related to the surface mass density. So the two eigenvalues of this matrix are 1 minus kappa, where so for type 1 images, both of them were positive. So relevant property of type 1 images, which you can see, is so from these relations, you have so you know that gamma is positive, right? And from this relation, you know that gamma is less than 1 minus kappa. And we know that kappa is positive. And so this thing should be less than 1. And in fact, since it's positive, its mod is strictly less than 1. So the magnification mu, which was 1 over 1 minus kappa square minus gamma square, is greater than. So type 1 images are always magnified relative to the unlensed case. So type 2 images had here. So I just wrote, so this is a symmetric 2x2 matrix. So I can decompose it in terms of its trace and the traceless symmetric part. So the trace is the kappa and the traceless symmetric part is the shear. So for type 2 images, the magnification is less than 0. That means one eigenvalue is positive, one eigenvalue is negative. And for And for type 3 images, the magnification is positive, but both the eigenvalues are negative. So I also told you yesterday that type 1 images are minima of the arrival time. Type 2 correspond to saddle points of the arrival time. And type 3 correspond to maxima of the arrival time. So someone was asking me, so you have images of all kinds in lensing that happen. So one useful thing that you should see is, so let's consider the infinitesimal displacement in the source plane. Let's consider two different infinitesimal displacements in the source plane and look at their chirality. So look at their cross products. So let's call dy1 and dy2 and compute. So using the Jacobian, we have this quantity is so you can see that when the determinant of the matrix is negative, the handedness is changing. So that means type 2 images are parity flipped with respect to the original image. So there is a mirror reflection about some axis there. So the time delay is proportional to this quantity here, right? So the psi of x, we wrote that it was so if we have a compact mass distribution and this mass distribution has a finite amount of total mass at large x, so far away on the image plane, right? It goes logarithmically, it dies away logarithmically, and the logarithm is because of the long range nature of the potential, right? But you can see that this term goes as a polynomial. So at large distances, you will always have a time delay surface that looks like this. It looks like a upward paraboloid. And inside, like deep inside, near the lens, some madness is going on, but this is always like this. So you always have, so this tells you that whatever is happening here, you are guaranteed to have a global minimum, right? So this tells you that there will always be a type 1 image, whatever be the lens distribution. Maybe one more implication is that there will always be one image of anything. So if you place a lens in between you and the source, the lens can never hide the source. it will just move it elsewhere, but you will always have an image. I mean, maybe this fact is obvious, but it's worth noting. So then we would like to know how many images of each kind there are, and if the so that depends on the precise form of the lens potential, because you have to solve, you have to basically solve this implicit lens equation for each potential. But there are some universal relations between the images, which I'll briefly go through. So around type 1 images, the Fermat potential, which is the time delay, we know that it looks like this. So because it's a local minimum. So type 2, it looks like. And type 3, it looks like this. So let's define a vector field, which is the gradient of the arrival time. So how does this vector field look at type 1, 2, and 3 images? At type 1, if the image is here, it's pointing radially outwards. For type 2 images, we have this classic saddle point behavior. And for type 3 images, it looks like this. So now let's look at, so we have this, I'm just showing, so this is the lens plane or the image plane. So on this plane, we can this is a vector field, because tau is a function that lives on the image plane. So this vector field, you know, it has some, you know, you'll have some crazy arrows everywhere. So let's define the notion of a function over a curve. So for any closed curve, on this plane, we'll define a function. So an integral of this curve. So it is some closed integral around the curve. And so what is it? So locally, when you're here, there's always a local tangent direction. So there's always a local, it's not necessarily tangent, but it's the direction of grad phi. Grad tau. So it has some angle. It makes some angle with respect to the x-axis. So let's call that angle here. So let's call that angle theta. So equals So given this, and you take the right branch of the inverse cosine, and you'll get this angle theta. So it goes from 0 to 2 pi. So let's define this quantity, which is d theta. So in words, what this is measuring is, if you start here, there is a local direction of this vector field, and as you move around, the vector field is changing. So this is measuring the number of cycles it's completing. Right. So this quantity, you can check that if the vector field is defined everywhere, so if these gradients are defined everywhere, you can smoothly deform the curve, and this quantity changes smoothly over it. So if the curve, if you could completely shrink the curve, that means this quantity is zero. Right. But every once in a while, you'll hit an image. So if you draw this curve, and inside there are some images here. So at the image, this gradient is zero, right? So this angle is undefined. So then you cannot shrink the curve past the image. So you have some curve here, and you have an image here where suddenly you cannot define it. So then what you do is you isolate the image out. So split the integral into one integral around this curve and an integral around this curve. And in this way, whenever you hit, you start with this curve far out on the image plane, where so that you, far enough so that you have all the images inside, and start shrinking it. And every time you hit an image, you close it. Right? So then you have the identity that this integral, if you take a given region in the image plane, so this is the sum of the integrals over the around each of the little images. So let's see how this integral looks for these three fields. No, this is on the image on the on, this is in angle space. So this is on the lens plane. Because the time delay surface is defined on the lens plane, right? The extrema of this on the lens plane are the images. So you have this thing. So let's look at what this thing is doing. So if you look at this, a type 1 image, you can see that this vector is starting here and then going around a full circle. So this integral around a type 1 image is 1. And you look at a type 2 image, as you go around this way, you'll see that this curve is going around this way. This vector is, as you go around this way, this direction of this vector goes around this way. So this integral is -1. And for a type 3 image, it's again 1. Okay. Yes. No, type 3's determinant is positive. Because it's the product of, okay. Okay. Yes. So, but now, so suppose we have this image plane and you have a few images of the source sitting here, and I made a curve which is far enough so that it's encompassing all the images. So we know that when it is far enough outside, it looks like this, and this integral will just be 1. So you have the identity that 1 equals the sum equals, so for each type 1 image, you get 1 here. So the number of type 1 images, each type 3 image, you get 1. Number of type 3, and I mean, this is sort of a mathematical trick, but you can. So this is satisfied in any lens equation, as long as the, apart from the images, you can define this gradient everywhere. So if the lens equation has a singularity, like if you have a point mass lens, you cannot define the gradient there. This identity breaks down. So yes, okay, but so what are the implications of this? So the total number of images, which is N1 plus N2, so the total number of images, so if you use this identity, right? So this tells you that for any lens for any reasonable surface mass distribution, the total number of images is always odd. Okay? But so in yesterday's tutorial, you must have solved the lens equation for a point mass. And if you remember, you had two images there. So this breaks there because of the singularity at the location of the point mass. And in nature, like if you take a galaxy, it's not singular. So if you take a reasonable surface mass distribution, you will always have an odd number of images. And one interesting thing is that So this final image, which makes the total number of images odd, it tends to be near the center of the lens. I'll show it to you explicitly later. It tends to be near the center of the lens and is heavily demagnified. So if you take a galaxy, I'll show an example. You'll have several images outside. So if this were a galaxy here, and there is a background source which is being lensed. And this source, you can have several cases where it has five images, say. So four images will be readily visible. And the fifth image will be here, where... No, the location of the lens. Yeah. So it will be right on the location of the galaxy. And it will be demagnified. So it's, in many cases, it's hard to see this because it's obscured by the light of the galaxy itself. So in lensing of an electromagnetic source, this fifth image is very hard to see, and it's typically not seen in any of the cases. But if you have a gravitational wave source, for example, which is lensed, then this will be demagnified, but it will not be obscured by the galaxy. It's just an interesting aside. If you have a single... Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, so... Well, when I count them, I'm counting them as it's positive. This is just an identity. I'm just computing the integral. Yes. So, I mean, this has no other physical meaning apart from I'm just evaluating this integral around the images. Each image of this kind contributes 1. Each image of this kind contributes -1 to this integral. So that's why this is okay. So, and finally, I think in the last part of this lecture, I'll spend some time on the behavior of the lens equation near these caustics. So the cost. So given a particular mass distribution on the lens plane, the caustics are places where this determinant vanishes, right? So they are contours of this equation. So did I say caustics? So those are the critical curves I mentioned yesterday, sorry. So they are, so each of these quantities is a function of x, right? So this is some scalar equation that if you make, so this is where they are contours of this equation. And if you, and I mentioned that the lens map is 1-1 when you go back from the lens plane to the source plane. So the caustics, they map to critical curves, sorry, the critical curves, they map to caustics on the source plane. So if I take these curves and map them via the lens equation to the source plane, I get what you would call caustics. And these are the only locations where the lens map, it loses its singular. So let's look at the vicinity of one such critical curve and caustic. So on the, again on the, on the lens plane, the source plane, so there is one point which satisfies this. See? So it's on some critical curve. And this point maps to some point which is on another contour, which are, as yet we don't know what they look like. So this is the caustic. And without loss of generality, let's set our origin to be on the lens plane to be here and on the source plane to be here. And you also saw that we could choose our coordinate system. So you looked at how gamma transformed under rotations of the coordinate system yesterday. So by an appropriate choice of the coordinate system, you can set gamma 2 to 0. And then you get a particular set of principal axes. So and now the Jacobian, it looks like so the determinant is just the product of these values. And it's zero here, so we can, by choosing it correctly, we can zero out the second component, say. So this is zero, and this will be twice of 1 minus kappa. So this is the Jacobian at this point. Let's call this P. So on the image plane, this tells you that the second direction is singular. So that's a special direction here. So this x2 hat is a direction that is singular. And there is another special direction, which is the critical curve here, if you're just sitting here. And what is it in terms of this? So in order to see that, you have to look at how this Jacobian varies as you move away from P. So we should do an expansion around P. So there'll be many derivatives, but they're not independent because the Jacobian has come to us from the derivative of the lens of this Fermat potential. So this was the gradient of psi. So this Jacobian, it's 1 minus psi 1, 1 psi 2, 2. So let's, or we can write it in terms of phi, which is the same thing. So this would be phi 1, 1, phi 2, 2. Sorry, phi 1, 1, phi 1, 2, phi 2, 1, phi 2, 2. So if you have a neighborhood of this point, so in a neighborhood, you can write this as 511, and then each of them has some derivative expansion. So let's write that down. So this is zero. We have chosen our axis so that the zeroth order parts of all of these are zero. Same thing here. So this is how the Jacobian looks like if you're not here but somewhere close. So the critical curve is defined by here is the determinant of this. So the local, so if you don't move away too far, the critical curve is locally like a straight line defined by its tangent vector. So that tangent vector is, if you take the determinant and retain only the first order terms, so that is So that means that the tangent vector to the critical curve is proportional to this, right? So this is something like this. And this vector is so the simplest kind of the singularity to study is when this vector and vector are linearly independent. So it turns out that you can classify all the cases where the Lenz equation fails into certain categories. So the first category is one where this trivial direction and the direction of the critical curve are different. So let's stick to that. Oh, so these are derivatives with respect to x1 and x2. Oh, because the zeroth order piece is 511. Yes. Yeah, at the point, they're all not relevant. Yes. So, yes. So where was I? Yeah. So now we are interested in how does the caustic look like on the source plane of this. So the caustic is just the map of this to the source plane, if you remember. So let's first write down the Lenz equation in terms of this 511. In terms of these derivatives, right? So, I chose my coordinate system so that the zero is at this point. So these are like angles. Yes. Well, you can choose, I rotated it a bit so that you're always, this is like Euclidean, this is like Riemannian geometry where you are just looking at a small patch and you are looking at how it looks. Locally, it will always look like R2. So you can always do this. So we wrote down the Lenz equation in terms of the deflection angle, but now we have written everything in terms of these phis. So let me write down, so you would like to know, given a set of x's, what are the source plane coordinates? So you can get that by, so you know that this is, so you know that phi is also given by an expansion with essentially these coefficients, right? And you know that the images satisfy that the gradient of phi is zero. So if you write down that term, that thing in terms of these coefficients, you get for y2, phi 22 is 0. So the first piece here. So phi has minus psi here. Right. And so we can see that if we set x1 and x2 to 0, we are go to 0, 0. That's how we chose the coordinate system. And now let's ask, so if I infinitesimally move along the critical curve, where does my source plane location move? That is the caustic, right? So we are going to move always satisfying this identity. So that will tell us let's just stick to what I had earlier. And y1, so the x's are small displacements, so we can neglect these. So you can see that this, if you think of x1 as a parameter, this is the equation of a parabola, right? So this tells you that the caustic on the source plane is locally like a parabola, and it's so this is y1 is like y2 square. Y2 is like y1 square, so that means it's tangent to the x direction. So say it curves like this. So this critical curve maps to a parabola, which is curved some way. Okay. So now let's ask what happens if instead of now let's go back to the source plane. So for this point was mapped to here. So now let's imagine that I move the source infinitesimally on the source plane, and we would like to see what happens on the image. So this is. And I'm assuming that x1 and x2 are small displacements. So for y2, I just substituted this. And then, okay. Yes. So this is telling you that, so now imagine that I have a source that is moving, and let's move it along the y2 direction, okay? And let's ask what happens to the on the image plane. So when it is at the origin, there's only one image that's here. So to lowest order, essentially, if I move y2 by a small amount, x1 is not affected, and x2 so let's say I move from 0 to delta y, I'll put a delta to signify that we are moving infinitesimally. So then you have delta x2. So it's a quadratic equation. So that tells you that two images start moving out on the image plane. One image moves up and the other image moves down, as on the source plane this thing moves up. Okay? And if you were here, then this quadratic equation has no roots, so no real roots. If I assume a sign for phi 2 2, so that means as you move on the source plane, as you move across the caustic, image is born here and then it splits into two and moves across, right? So what are the properties of these two images? So we would like to know their magnification and their time delay. So before we get into the calculation, so this particular singularity of the lens map is called a fold. And you can see why it gets its name, because this is the singularity you get for if you recall, I said that you should think of the lens map as just a map from the source plane to the image plane. So it's a map, and imagine that this map is where the source plane is sitting here. And the image plane is this thing that's folded. And for every point on the source plane, the image is you go up and see where it intersects this sheet. So when you're on this side, there is no image on this branch. And then as you start moving, you first hit this, and then two images are born, and then they move this way, hence the name. So just think of a line that's moving like this. And when it hits this, two images are born, and then they move apart. So I'm deriving the, yes. Yes. So where were we? Yes. So the folds aren't the only singularities, but there is some general mathematical theory of these singularities of these smooth maps. And the most generic kind of singularity is called this fold. So it occurs not just in gravitational lensing, but in lots of other places. So if we substitute, these relations into the lensing Jacobian and compute the magnification, we get that. So this is the inverse of this. So you see that this just comes from substituting this into this matrix and computing the determinant. So you see that one generic property of these highly magnified images near the critical curve is that their magnification goes as the inverse square root of the separation of the source from the caustic on the source plane. Okay, and the lens plane separation is the separation between. You can see here that the lens plane separation is the separation between these two branches. So the lens plane separation goes as the square root of the separation from the caustic on the source plane. And finally, the relevant thing is the time delay. So we would like to know what's the difference in arrival time between these two highly magnified images. And that we just have to substitute this. You just have to substitute these lowest order terms into the equation. You know that the time delay is proportional to phi, right? The change in phi. So it's not singular everywhere. So in the point mass case, so yesterday you would have solved it in the tutorial. For the point mass, the critical curve is the Einstein ring. Right, the circle, right, and the caustic on the source plane is a point. So this is a degenerate case. Well, in this case, you cannot think of the source plane caustic is no longer like a curve; it's singular. But imagine that instead of having a delta function at the origin, you had some Gaussian or something. You smoothed it out. Then you would see that the source plane would no longer be a point. I'll show you an example of this. Well, if you are on the caustic, it is zero, right? Yes. Yes. So in the point, so let me just, I'll show you later what happens if you smooth the mass distribution, then you will generically see that the critical curve, it has some perturbation, but it's not super changed extremely a lot. But the caustics, it will change from a point to something like this. Okay, and outside here there'll be one image, and when you move here there'll be three images. So you saw that the, but. So for the time delay, so if we, I want to get a. So you know that the time delay. So and the so both the images have the same y, but they have different x's. So the time delay is y times delta x. So you can see from this that the time delay goes as delta y 2 to 3/2. Okay. So the time delay goes as delta y 2 to the 3/2, and if you actually put in the numbers and go through it, you will find that but this has no units, right? This is just, so the units will be the Schwarzschild crossing time. As I mentioned earlier, the characteristic time delay is the Schwarzschild crossing time. So from these scalings, you can see that the time delay for the highly magnified images goes as it goes as the inverse of the cube of the magnification. So in the case of the galaxy lenses, for example, I mentioned that the crossing time is of the order of a year. But if you have a highly magnified image, which is near the critical curve and the source is close to the caustic, then the time delay will be, in general, much shorter. Okay, you can go to, I mean, if you're on the caustic, it's exactly zero. But yes. So this is a property of these things. And so the two images, they approach each other or move away along this degenerate direction, right, of this lens map. So I wanted to show an example. So in yesterday's tutorial, you would have solved the lens equation for a singular isothermal lens, where the surface mass density falls off in with the power law from the origin, right? And so in order to demonstrate these things that I talked about today, so I'm solving the lens equation for a case where I have the same SIS model, the singular isothermal model, but I soften the singularity at the center by adding a core. Okay, so instead of it going to infinity, it goes to some constant. And I also broke the circular symmetry by adding a ellipticity so that both directions are not the same. So if it is circularly symmetric, you cannot have any strange thing going on. So here, maybe I can make this bigger. So the solid curves are the, for this particular model, they are the caustics on the source plane, and these dashed blue curves are the critical curves on the image plane. So this is a source, and this source outside this region has one image. In here has three images, two are born, right? And in here it has five images. So, and I'm showing the image here of the source, and you'll see how it moves when I move the source. And this is not the true image of a circle, but just the principal ellipse of this lensing Jacobian. So two new images are born at a critical curve, right? So they're born here. You can see that both of them, they're stretched in the same direction, which is the direction where the Jacobian vanishes of the lens map, and then they move away along that direction. And they are also highly magnified as. And then two images are again born when you hit the second critical curve. So I mentioned that there are always an odd number of images. So there are five images here. And this is the, I don't know if you can see, but there's a demagnified image at the center. So if this lens potential was because of a galaxy, this would be buried inside the galaxy because the galaxy has its own light. And in fact, then when you move out again, the images merge, and then you're left with one image. And I think that's what I wanted to show. Yes. Okay, I have 1 minute, so maybe I will. I wanted to talk about what these singularities and how they manifest in light curves of stars that are being lensed, but I'll keep that for tomorrow. And if you have any questions, like.
Yes. Cell cross.
Yes.
I didn't quite understand why that is becoming bigger as you move away from the mass.
You mean this thing?
Yeah.
Because once you. So you can think of this new thing as a new source. Right? And the wavefront is again expanding from that source. So this branch of the wavefront is again expanding away from that.